Today I'm going to talk to you about the miracle of spaced repetition. Cool. So we're going to go through four principles about remembering things, and that'll give us an idea of what we need to do, and then I'll talk about how we can do it. So the first principle is that, I can walk around because I have a microphone on me, there are things that you want to remember. You can't just look up everything. There's some things that are worth memorizing. For example, you can write more clearly if you have a larger vocabulary. If you have a lot of words that you can use without looking them up. And you could prove new theorems faster in a field if you know all the definitions by heart and you know the major theorems that you can use to prove new ones. And you can program better if you know all the keywords in the standard libraries of the language. And if you know how to do simple things, like you have the programs for really simple common tasks memorized, then you can program a lot faster than if you had to look up how to sort an array or whatever. And if you meet someone from Montgomery, you can say, oh, that's in Alabama, and make a connection with them. Whereas if you met someone from Montgomery and then Googled Montgomery and then said, oh, that's in Alabama, then they would be like, I could have told you that. You didn't need to look it up.
But you know, the Google thing, you can actually swap that. And that would be great.
Yeah, like
Hank Williams.
Yeah, that too. Yeah. And you can, Google is good for certain things. If you will only ever need it a couple times, and there's a clear prompt, then it works well. Like, who won the Super Bowl in 1955? That's something you can Google, and you'll rarely need. But if you're just trying to express an idea, and it's vague in your head, there's not something to look up at all. You just need to know it. The second principle is that we do actually forget things. So if you just learn something once, you will not know it for the rest of your life, typically, the way things typically work. But all four of the principles are going to be sort of obvious, but together, so you give us a clear picture. This is called the forgetting curve. It was originally done in 1885 by this guy, Erman Ebbinghaus. And he memorized some nonsense sounds. And he immediately tested himself and he was able to remember all of them. After 20 minutes, he could only remember about 2/3 of the sounds. And then after an hour less, after 9 hours less, and after a day, it basically stabilized out and he only remembered a fifth of what he originally learned. 20%'s not bad. Yeah, and this also happens if you cram for a biology exam. You memorize 45 definitions of parts of the cell, and then you remember most of them while you're still taking the exam, and then the next day you remember mitochondria, and that's it. This experiment was originally done in 1885, but it's been done many, many times since then. This was done in 2010. The third principle is that testing works. By testing, I mean testing as you learn. So if you want to memorize a fact, it's better to read it, try to recall it, read it, try to recall it, read it, try to recall it, than it is to just read it over and over and over. This is a bunch of papers about that. It's upside down so you don't try to read it. But this is compiled by Gwern, or I think his first name is Michael Gwern. He's a researcher. He has this excellent analysis about spaced repetition. It's on Gwern.net, or can Google Gwern. But these are some of the major papers that show that testing works. We're going to do a little testing ourselves. We're going to learn two random poems. Canada Goose Gosling. This is the giant Canada goose. It's a good example of urban wildlife in parks because we don't see much wildlife.
I think it is too.
Yeah. Okay. And this is the grey-eyed goose at St. James Park in London. All right, so turn to your neighbor or the nearest person to you if you don't have an actual neighbor, and try to repeat the poem that you just read three times, if you dare. How many of you were able to get the first line at all?
The first line.
You got it?
Just one word.
Nice. All the words but one, that's good. How many of you got the second line?
Yeah, you all got it.
Hey. Okay, so collectively you got the first two lines. Did you get the third line? Nice.
That's the only one I memorized.
Okay. We're going to try learning as testing as you go. Another random poem. This is some snow geese in Quebec. I just need like any sort of spacing between the testing, so I'm doing the geese. Okay, so turn to your neighbor and try to repeat the poem. Or just whisper it to yourself, just like any form of like testing would work. And if you have no idea what it said, you should just make something up because you punish yourself more for a wrong answer than you do for choosing not to answer. You know what I mean? Yeah, so do that. Are you upset that the poems are random instead of sensical poems?
You said make something up if you're not sure.
That was good. Okay. This is the correct answer. These are some Chinese geese. They're the domesticated form of the swan goose. So guess again what the poem that you just read was. Evaluates. Yeah. Okay, and we'll skip the last one. But this is a Cape Barren goose. This is my favorite goose. Its beak is really short compared to the other geese. If you guess right now, you'd get probably two out of the three lines. Correct. Yeah. So that's also pretty obvious that guessing as you go is much better for memorizing something, but we like forget to do that a lot. Like if you're like trying to memorize song lyrics, sometimes I'll just say like, I wish you would never back down, I wish you'd never back down, I wish you'd never back down, and repeat to myself over and over, but it's much more effective to try to read it from your memory and then read the answer. These are some Canada geese in flight. Their wings are really long. Okay. The fourth principle is that longer gaps between testing and learning result in longer memory. So it's better to give daily quizzes about your linear algebra definitions than it is to give a midterm and a final over your definitions. Because even if it's the same amount of total time spent on something, like even if you review the same definition a total of four times, it makes a big difference whether those four times are close together or spread out.
So longer gaps implies longer memory. Sounds like midterm and final would be better.
So, if you like, so you want to do daily quizzes, but you want to like put the definition in spread out over time. The thing with the midterm and the final is you memorize it just before the midterm, and then you take the midterm. Whereas with the daily quizzes, you have to reuse that piece of data over and over over time. Being very convincing. Shorter gaps, shorter memory. I'll be more clear. If you fix the number of reviews and then you choose how long to space the reviews, the longer the spacing, the longer you will remember it past beyond the reviews. This is one of the meta analyses about longer gaps, making you remember things longer. I'll read some of the abstract. The authors performed a main analysis of the distributed practice effect to illuminate the effects of temporal variables that have been neglected in previous reviews. This review found 839 assessments of distributed practice in 317 experiments located in 184 articles. Effects of spacing and lag were examined and they produce maximal retention when the interval between spacing was largest. Does that make sense? Okay. So you say to me, Luke, I believe that I want to learn, because it's like you can't just look up everything, that I will forget things if I just learn them once. And that I need to test myself as I learn things, and then I need to space my repetition across time. Okay? That sounds like a lot of things to keep track of. Like, you'd have to, like, put due dates on your index cards and, like, check through your index cards to see what's due today, or something like that. It would be a mess. But we live in the computer age, and we have software. And one of the softwares is called Anki. A-N-K-I, and it keeps track of everything for you, and it works really, really well. So I'm gonna, we're gonna make a few Anki cards together and study together. So I'm gonna mess with the display a little bit. Let's hope nothing breaks. Cool. All right, these are really small. That's fine. Is everything legible? Yes. Cool. Yeah? Great.
Is the first word supposed to be varus or avarice?
I think it's supposed to be avarice. Typo. Thanks. So this is what Anki looks like when you open it up. I'll close all this stuff. You get to see your decks of cards. You get to see how many old cards you have to review today, how many new cards you gotta look up today, you gotta learn today. You can make new cards, you can browse through all your existing cards. I have a lot of cards. I'll show you some of them. Let's see the current deck. I have a Greek alphabet. Some research stuff, some vocabulary, linear algebra, more vocabulary. You can put any sort of thing in here. It's like very broad in how you can apply Anki. Like, it's not just like words and definitions. So We make a new deck. We'll call it Keep Current. Flip and Keep Current. Add some new cards. There are different types of cards. Basic, you just get shown the front and you have to guess the back. Basic with reverse, you get shown either side and you have to guess the other side. And close is like you put in something and you specify what you want to cut out. And then it'll show you like a sentence with a blank and you have to fill in the blank. So vocab is good with basic and reversed because sometimes you want to guess the word from the definition, sometimes you want to guess the definition from the word. The shortcut command enter to hit add. For math, my favorite type of card is close. I'll show you how you can use close. So pick close. And so this theorem, maybe we want to learn the name of the theorem, the left-hand side of the implication, and the right-hand side. So we highlight the name of the theorem. This is the close button. There's also a shortcut, but.
In this case, we also might.
Yeah, you can also attach names to this and memorize the names. I'm trying to memorize authors of papers so that when I go to a conference, I can say, oh, you wrote the thing, or I can not trash talk that paper to the author. Anki also does LaTeX, which is really cool. So here, this might be like nice as an equation. So we put LaTeX equation. And there's keyboard shortcuts for this too. We do it like that. And so we might want to remember this property is called associative. So we close that. And we want to remember what associative means. So we close all this. Does that make sense?
Can you make the cards as a CSV file and import a bunch of cards?
Yeah, you can import from Quizlet. You can import from CSV or other file types. Yeah. Programming, you also want close deletion. So like, maybe you want to memorize this code snippet. So given the code snippet, you want to be able to say what it does. So you close that. And given a description, you want to be able to produce a code snippet. So you could either close this whole thing, or if you wanted, you could close it line by line. So that way, a card shows you like a missing line. You have to fill in that line. And this works really well. Like for programming team, for example, you memorize like factoring algorithms and save you a lot of time in competitions because at least like one or two problems are just a factoring algorithm. You can memorize programming keywords. Maybe you want to memorize the input to a function, or maybe you want to memorize the name of a function. Maybe you want to memorize the description of a function. And maybe Grandma Jean's always angry at you because you never remember her birthday. So this could be a basic with reverse card. We just made a lot of cards. We're going to study them. The studying interface is an important part about this work. What's avarice? It's like something to do with how colorful a word is, and I'd show the answer, and I'd be completely wrong. So I'd mark again because I didn't understand it at all. Or if I did get it, I'd mark it as good or easy. These things above it mean how long it is till you get that card again. So if you mark something as easy, then you don't have to review it for as long a time. And this way you can keep like thousands of cards in your decks and memorize like thousands of facts, but not have much time spent reviewing each day, because if you know them well, you don't get the cards very often.
Can you change those things?
You can, like, put in custom things, but I marked easy, and I get 4 days. If I marked it, if this is a card I was reviewing, and I'd already marked it easy, this would be, like, a 12-day. And, like, the Greek alphabet I put in over a month ago, and I've, like, studied the card several times. So now when I mark alpha as easy, it's, like, 6 months till I have to review that card again. Given a letter, say the name of the letter. I'm using LaTeX for that. Yeah, because it's like hard to read equations if you're like squiggle squared plus half squiggle. Cool. A Greek person who eats a lot of Greeks.
No.
Oh man.
Maybe it's look after studying.
I think it's called Fundamental Theorem of Calculus. Oh man. There's the LaTeX. You can actually put the dot 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 inside the LaTeX. Associative. That was easy. Print knowledge advisors of 100. Filter takes. Interval and a function. A function and interval, yeah, and so on. Here you see these times are a little the same, but sometimes these times change depending on how you have to see the card. LaTeX also, Anki also takes images, so I put in the United States states and capitals. I think this one is Arizona. Yeah. Does anyone know? Will? Denver? Hey, nice. Yeah. It's really easy to create your own images, so. I had it pulled up. Let's see. So, let's say. I kept running into this certain CS faculty, and I could never remember their name, so I wanted to make an Anki card. Then I can just copy their face picture.
See, wait till you left.
Paste it in, and add it, and then when I study my concurrent deck. Did I put it in the wrong deck?
I think so. Put it in the other one.
So this is what it looks like. And I'd be like, I think he's like wears glasses and he's white. He usually wears button-ups. Yeah, that kind of. Okay, that's all. I hope you guys can go download Anki and start learning things. Thanks. Question?
How did Anki get its name?
I don't know. Maybe it's on the Wikipedia page. Some people use these Anki to memorize all the Wikipedia introductions of all the featured articles, which I think would be too much. Other questions?